Thank you.
Good group.
Thank you. That's very nice. I know what you're all thinking. TGIF. Thank God it's free. Are you going to be that easy? Anyway, thank you for coming. Today is Friday, October the 9th, 1987. This is the day to remember, because this, the big one, didn't happen again. Are you still a little shaky from the last one? I had. You ever wake up in the morning and know that the day might not be going just too well?
Yeah.
Woke up this morning, wasn't quite awake. Looked over and Bob Woodward's on the edge of my bed with a notepad. Nice. Very nice. I usually kid your clothes, but that's what a leader should look like. You know, that suit is woven from 3,000 fur balls coughed up by Tommy's cat. His doc is still in Milwaukee.
Milwaukee.
He went back, you said, not for the baseball game. He went back to play a concert?
That was my era, yes. He went for a concert.
Went for a concert?
With the symphony.
With the Milwaukee Symphony?
Correct. Yes.
Okay. Here's a... Sometimes we hit, sometimes we don't. There's a late-breaking bulletin you probably did not see because you've been here for an hour or so, but Pat Robertson just asked Lee Iacocca to roll back the date on his marriage license. It was, look, I'm... No, poor Pat, it is getting mean out there. I mean, poor Pat Robertson. Come on, big deal. I mean, presidential candidates are going down faster than Iranian gunboats. Pat Robertson, you know, came out like a decent fellow and admitted that he had had premarital sex. I mean, my man's been married 33 years. Big deal, right? If everybody here was running for office and had to admit that you had premarital sex, how many of you'd walk out of here scot-free tonight? But, what?
That's true, sir. I wouldn't touch a woman I wasn't married to.
When you were around, there was only one woman. Anyway, a lot of the politicians are coming out now reacting to Pat Robertson's confession. Gary Hart said today, "I'm shocked that a politician would have sex with his wife." Governor Dukakis said, "I never knew my campaign aides release that information." And Joe Biden said, "Give me liberty or give me death." I mean, it is. Wait, listen. We are going through a crazy period in history, right? The candidates now, you see, because they know the reporters are going to find out things, are now opening up all kinds of former little things that happened. Jesse Jackson today admitted when he was a teenager he had an inflatable Lena Horne. Big deal. Jerry Falwell admitted he had an extramarital fling with a water slide at the PTL. I mean, did you hear what Jerry Falwell said yesterday? Mr. Warmth and Mr. Innuendo, master of the metaphor, called Jim and Tammy Baker. I quote Jerry Falwell. He said of Jim and Tammy Baker, "They are the greatest scab and cancer on the face of Christianity in 2,000 years. And Tammy said, "Does my makeup look that bad?" I mean, that's true. Yeah, you got a bunch. Let's call it as it is. We got a bunch of wacko religious leaders these days. Jerry Falwell sliding down a water slide. The Bakers are on Dial-A-Joke. You can phone them. Next thing you know, Billy Graham will be on his crusade with an arrow through his head like Steve Martin, you know. I don't. Well, anyway, looks like Judge Bork's nomination is dead. This is nothing political here, but it's not a total loss for Bork. His Halloween mask is selling like hotcakes. I sometimes wonder about Reagan's choices. With Bork out, his next nominee is Bess Meyerson. I don't know if this thing is going to work. Aww. comedy sometimes is cruel. Are the playoffs are? Have you watched the playoff games, Minnesota? The fans there have something called Homer hankies. Have you seen 60,000 people wave their little hankies when their team scores? Now they have the same thing up at San Francisco during the ball games. What's your joke? Usually it's to get a date for the weekend. They don't care about, I don't. They have a similar thing in Dodger Stadium. It's called a white flag. Yeah. Have you noticed, this is interesting. During the playoffs on the baseball games, the networks are running what they call public service announcements, urging fans not to drink too much at the ball games. Immediately followed by 19 light beer commercials. Is this a holiday weekend coming up?
Yes.
What do we say? It's Columbus Day and there's another?
Columbus Day.
Columbus Day. Every year somebody comes out and says Columbus landed a different island, right? It's supposed to be Salvador or the Indies or something. Actually, Columbus landed here, was greeted by friendly Indians. And the first thing they told him, and whether you know this or not, in case of an earthquake, you stand in the doorway of a teepee. Did you hear today the football strike is apparently over? Yeah, it was announced that the regular players are going to, I guess, will play this Sunday. Unfortunately for the Rams, because they were doing pretty good. Are you following the Valerie Harper story?
Yes.
Yeah, you know, she apparently left the show. Then she sued Lorimar Productions because they were using the name Valerie's family. So they went before a judge, and the judge ruled that they could use Valerie this year, but next year they cannot use the title Valerie and the Family. So Lorimar is pretty smart. They're going to change it to the Bill Cosby Show so they can get big ratings until he sues. So it's a long joke, and it's a studied joke. Yuck, yuck yourself, Satsang. Today, by the way, kind of a special day, the 68th anniversary. You probably don't know, this is the 68th anniversary of the very first in-flight meal served on an airplane. Did you know that? They would have had in-flight meals about 10 years earlier, but it took scientists about a decade to figure out how to make coffee that tastes like lukewarm Lysol. Had enough? Okay. All right. Tonight. Okay. Tonight we have a young man who's in a very, very hot movie called Dirty Dancing, Patrick Swayze. Did you dance? Have you seen any scenes from that picture?
No.
Is that dancing or what? We used to do the dip, you know. This is not the dip. This is about as... never seen anything like that. Who else is on the show? We have a young comedian from Saturday Night Live who used to be on the show, A. Whitney Brown. A is here. And beautiful. What? Excuse me?
He is on the show tonight.
Well, didn't I say he was on the show?
He used to be on the show.
Well, what I said, he was on the show before he did Saturday Night Live.
Said.
Oh, exactly what did I say? I said we have A. Whitney Brown from Saturday Night Live who used to be on the show.
Yeah.
That's exactly what I said, wasn't it?
Right.
Was as far as I could hear.
That's not what he said.
He's on here. Anyway, A is here tonight. I know him very well. I just call him A. And a beautiful young actress by the name of Alexandra Paul is also with us. So stay where you are. Okay. Friday night. Thank you. Boys, you know you got a good show cooking when it's a Friday night audience and there's a full moon.
Right.
Got both of it tonight. Two guys from our orchestra are going to be appearing in concert at the Paramount Theater in Denver, Colorado on October 10th. That would be tomorrow, right?
Right.
Saturday and Sunday. I'm talking about Mr. Ross Tompkins, who's not even there.
No.
Obviously, Ross is on the plane already for Denver. What the hell is with Ross? It doesn't take that long to get to Denver. You gave him a day off early?
He found out he was in California.
And he's going with Snooki? Is Snooki here tonight?
Snooki's gone, too.
Is Snooki gone, too? These guys must be on the frequent flyer program. I mean, anyway, Ross Tompkins and Snooki Young, we're going to be at the Paramount Theater in Denver tomorrow night and Saturday. Go see them. They're great musicians. Okay. What was that, Fred?
Tomorrow night is Saturday.
Now, Fred. Those Norinos are really flaking off. I said they're going to be in Denver Saturday, tomorrow, and Sunday. That's the 11th. Isn't that what I said?
Sounded great to me.
Why are you doing this to me, Fred? Well, now, what is that again, Fred?
Who?
You said he's...
I'm having dinner with what?
No, wait. That's the Reagan sketch.
The man said, I said, tomorrow is Saturday. And isn't that what I said right here? I said...
Tomorrow night and Saturday.
Tomorrow night and Saturday.
Tomorrow night.
Is that what I said? All right.
Well, that is a mistake.
What?
That is a mistake.
Okay, all right. I said tomorrow night and Saturday. I made a boob. Terrible me. Big deal, big
bad
deal.
Boy.
Bad boy. Bad John. We handed out some cards here. Is David Teal with us?
Where are you, David?
It says David Teal. All right, David. We're here on our honeymoon. Any suggestions? Are you really on your honeymoon, David?
Yes, sir.
Well, happy marriage. We're on our honeymoon. Any suggestions, being the expert that you are? What to do in Los Angeles on a honeymoon? I'll tell you what, David, you don't do a thing. You lie in bed, wait for the earthquake. We call it God's magic fingers. Right, you don't have to wait. Where are you from, David? How long you been married?
6 days.
6 days. How's it going so far? A week, not yet a week. Not bad. Okay. Is Mrs. Teal with you?
Yes, she's here.
Okay, all right. Meredith Gould? Where are you, Meredith? Oh, come on now. Now, listen to this. Bitchin' is a word you use, isn't it?
Sure.
I mean, it's all
yeah.
right. Me and my bitchin' bachelorette buddies are in town to meet some special dudes. Are you and Ed interested? Meredith. Thank you, Meredith, but me and my bitchin' buddy Ed here are married, and if we do that, some dude's gonna get our bitchin' money and our bitchin' house. But anyway, thank you. Very nice of you. In earlier years, we would have seized upon
sure,
that opportunity. Moments in our life when
yes,
we were, as we say, loose. Tommy, Angelo, and Annette, Kim, Ronnie, and Jennifer. You all together?
Yes!
Throw them out. No. We would like to know when the chances of you, what are the chances of six hungry Texans getting dinner with you and the Tonight Show crew? About as much chance of Judge Bork doing a Gillette commercial. But no. Later. Don. Doug Adams, Washington, D.C. Where are you, Doug?
Right here.
That's where we get all our comedy material. That's
right.
That's the source of the monologue, is Washington, D.C. In all your years on The Tonight Show, what's been your most embarrassing moment? That's a little strange. I don't know. We've had some strange ones.
Yeah.
I think the night I had the shouting match with Gandhi.
Yeah.
Gandhi would have been across at the happy hour, and we
oh,
came
yeah.
over and...
Yeah. That was a tough night.
Yes.
Yeah.
He said, I don't think I'm coming back on the show.
Shelley Peterson. Where are you from, Shelley? Where?
Hermosa Beach.
Hermosa Beach, all right. For as long as I've been old enough to watch TV. You've been the host of The Tonight Show. Did you have a job before that? Sure.
Sure.
Sure, lots of things. Remember, I was a lounge comic in an...
That's right.
In an Amish lounge room? Dick Hamilton, how much would you guess Ed weighs? I used to joke about Ed's weight, but you lost about 25 or 30 pounds in the last...
35 so far.
35 yeah. pounds in the last...
Thank you.
I haven't done... But before that...
Well, before that.
Before that, if we'd had an earthquake, Ed kept us in the Western Hemisphere. but now, that doesn't work, you see. We save them in case... If you get bigger, we can go back to the
again,
old
yeah.
jokes. Throw nothing away. Emmanuel... Rico, no, help me on this, Emmanuel. Emmanuel Rico Tato? Excuse me? Rico Otto? Emmanuel, that's very nice. You are from France. Whereabouts in France? Where? Où? Ah, si. C'est un plaisir, vous êtes très aimable. Ah, there you are.
Hey. Very fancy.
All right, what do you like? I know you go to France often. What do you like about France? Why you go there so often? I like to go see Marcel Marceau work and then tell people, hey, he's not really trapped in a box. That's the favorite thing I love to do. Karen Jackson. Where are you, Karen? Where are you from, Karen?
Oh, dear.
Pretty, and it's a pretty thrilling moment, isn't it, Karen? You know, I'm here. I have no place to go. If the mall was open, I wouldn't even come here. What is your most interesting fantasy?
Yeah.
Well, look, we all have those little yeah. peccadillos. Yeah. I suppose it involves Victoria Principal and two of Sherry Lewis's hand puppets. It's hard to explain. What are you going to do this year for Halloween? Stay locked up inside my house, I think, with a gun and a flashlight, no. What is the key factor in creating a relationship that lasts your entire life?
Oh. Please tell us.
Get All right. You get married at 90. That's what it is. No. Anyway, thanks for those questions, folks. We're going to be back with Patrick Swayze, Whitney Brown, Alexandra Paul, many other people. Okay. Okay, I apparently have a correction to make. You know, Freddie corrected me in the
right.
monologue, then he corrected me
right.
about the tomorrow and Saturday. Well, he just came up again and told me that I had mentioned in the monologue the football strike has ended. Apparently, it has not ended. Yeah. Apparently, some of the players, I guess, have elected to play on Sunday, but not all of the teams right. have said. So, anyway.
Right.
But I lied because I had a good joke. If you have a good joke, you can lie. That's comedy rule number 7. Anyway, the strike isn't over, but I guess they're going to play this Sunday. Have you watched the pickup games?
Yes.
Not too professional. Give me the ball, Harry. You know, it's like watching Sandlot football. It's kind of fun.
Right.
Because you see a lot of goofy plays. The quarterback comes back and he falls down. And anyway, my first guest was here last year after he was in that hit series North and South. And now he's got a movie out that's a big hit called Dirty Dancing. Would you welcome Patrick Swayze? Listen to that, you see?
Not too shabby.
Not too shabby, huh? Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
I remember when you were here before, and I've seen clips. I have not seen the whole movie, but I have seen clips of it. That's some dancing.
Not too shabby.
Not too shabby at all. We talked about when you were on the show. You were a dancer, right?
Yeah.
I mean, professionally. Where did you start?
Well, my mother's a choreographer. She had a dance company in Texas for 25 years, and
Yes, sir. Texas.
When you were growing up, was it considered sissy? You know, I mean, if my mother had sent me to dancing class, it was bad enough to take piano lessons, but your mother being a choreographer, I suppose you felt it was perfectly normal.
Well, I got a lot of scars on my knuckles from teeth.
Yeah, when guys would say, hey,
but,
you're dancing.
Yeah. And my father started me in martial arts and things from the time I was real little to...
Good combination.
Except a little bit of martial arts will get you killed.
Yeah.
So I got my face beat in over and over when I was growing up until finally I decided to turn into the very thing I hated, which I only realized about 3 or 4 years later. I decided I didn't want that in my life and got into Oriental martial stuff.
Yeah. Most people who look at dancing, you know, it's not a lot of guys say it, but you got to be in tremendous physical shape. I admire you. You go see ballet, and where a lot of people might put it down, they're probably about pound for pound, I would guess, in as good a shape as any male athlete who does anything, right?
I believe so, because a longer muscle is a stronger muscle. I can still bench press as much as I used to when coaches forced me to lift weights, and at that time I had 19 and a half inch arms. I looked like Godzilla versus dance.
Yeah.
And I worked real, real hard. Well, also, I had tons and tons of major knee surgeries, so I worked hard.
Now, what happened with losing? Was that from dancing or what?
First, football. I got blindsided on a kickoff. Second, gymnastics, because I went to college on a gymnastics scholarship. And I caused 3 more operations because I couldn't accept the limitation. I went ahead and danced with ballet companies in New York for 7 years. Then I got a staph infection in the joint. I hate this story.
Yeah, but you should be on a soap opera. This is General Hospital. Now, this is all came from football, athletic-related injuries, and then dancing.
Yeah, and I got a staph infection in the joint where they're supposed to... It was real possible they're going to take my leg off. They had a week in which to try to save it. Because it got it from an abscessed tooth. They couldn't, because I didn't have any money for a dentist at the time. I was living in a junky little rat-infested basement apartment. And, you know, ballet dancers don't make a whole lot of money.
And then... I was looking for an up interview. This is the saddest thing I've ever heard in my life. They told me you had injuries, but I didn't know you were coming completely unglued here. But everything is in pretty good shape now?
Yeah, it made me crazy for a while. But
now, this latest picture you did, we're going to see a clip when we come back. Were you injured in doing any of this in the dance at all?
Well, actually, I showed up. Well, the knee, I had to go to the hospital a couple of times just to get it drained.
I don't want to hear any more about it.
But I had to do a Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous with my wife, Lisa, right before. And I
saw that. You were on the ranch with the horses.
Uh-huh. And I did a roping segment, you know, because I calf rope. And I decided to make it exciting. And I hadn't roped in a few months, and I didn't warm up before I got on my horse. And I decided, let's make it exciting and rope in a roping lane. You know, it's a much faster form of roping in a lane because the calf can't duck and dive like in an arena. You can only go straight, and those little suckers are fast. So I was at a dead run where my horse was real splayed out. And I hadn't roped in a bit and wasn't in time with my cues with the horse, so I leaned forward a little bit too soon and he locked it up while just as my leg was coming off the horse. So to not look stupid on camera, it took everything I could to keep myself on that horse. So I ripped my groin muscle, so I had to go through the whole...
Do me a favor.
Well, I'm leaving now.
If you ever do that show again, that's Lifestyles?
Yeah.
Would you rope Robin Leach for me? Tie him up? We'll be right back, if you're still alive. We're back. We are talking with Patrick Swayze, and we do have a paramedic standing by, just in case.
In case I trip up.
In case you fall down here. A lot of our gals in the office were kind of going a little bananas when they heard you were coming in. Did you have the same effect on women because of this movie? They respond to you in a certain way, don't they?
Yeah.
I mean, seriously.
Yeah.
Because it's an uninhibited dancing type of thing.
Sort of.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure people are responding to you in the idle way as much as you're more of a catalyst for them to release, you know, because you're even though these days it's not just young girls.
Right.
I think, like, when you watch the eyes, when you watch their eyes, it's like, I think we all have to find a way to release things in our insides. I mean, people do it on motorcycles, cars, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. But I think that's the point where I think people screw themselves up as actors if, listen to me. If you start believing
this stuff. They identify with the person rather than the image that you're actually portraying.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And, I think it's real important to remember that, hopefully The reason they start reacting like that is that you affected them with your work.
And that's the main thing for an actor, right?
Although, but people, I think, don't know what to do with that kind of emotion, so they direct it into a sexual energy and,
Yes. But, problem we haven't suffered too much with on this show. Tell you what, why don't we show a film clip, if people have not seen this, and it'll give you some idea of, does this need, as they say, a setup? Brooke Shields is not in this, is
no,
he?
No.
Okay, I'm so used to doing this with Bob Hope, and every time he's a clip, Brooke Shields is in it, right? Name comes up.
This, the film is set in the Catskill Mountains of New York in 1963, and it's a really sweet little love story about, a very unlikely love story between this...
You're an employee there, right?
Yeah.
Teaching dancing.
Dance instructor.
You're not supposed to mix with the guests,
no,
actually.
No, I'm from Arthur Murray School of Dance from the streets of Philadelphia.
You just teach them and leave them. So, this is what this is about, and you fall in love with this girl?
Yeah.
Okay, here's a little excerpt from Dirty Dancing.
Hey, my frame, where's my pleasing art? Spaghetti arms, could you give me some tension, please? You're invading my dance space. This is my dance space, that's yours. That's cha-cha. Don't look down. Look right here.
Sylvia!
Yes, Mickey?
How do you call your lover boy?
Come here, lover boy.
And if he doesn't answer?
Oh, lover boy.
And if he still doesn't answer?
I simply say, baby. Oh, baby. My sweet baby. You're
dance lessons. I could teach a kid.
Different dancing.
Yeah. That wasn't like one of the hottest dance sequences, but...
I know. We saw a lot of scenes from this picture, and this is the one that we could actually play at this time of night. That was one of the milder dances. That was in the 60s?
Yeah.
We weren't dancing like that in the 40s.
Well, in private. You weren't dancing like that in private?
Oh, no. No, it was this kind of stuff.
Was that...
No touching!
Was that before your hair went gray?
What?
Sorry, no.
No, that's what made the hair go gray. Yeah. Anyway, good luck with the picture. I understand it's a big hit for you.
Thanks.
Okay, we'll take a break. We'll be right here. Whitney Brown is here. Alexander Paul. Okay, my next guest. Okay. My next guest, as I said in the billboard, and not used to be on this show... He now is one of the writers and performers on Saturday Night Live, which premieres its new season next weekend, October 17th. He's a fine stand-up comedian. Would you welcome A. Whitney Brown?
You know, when you boil this whole Bork brouhaha down to its basics, I think what it's been is a debate over the history of the Constitution. I think the one thing we've all learned is that history is a tricky thing. You can't get it mixed up with the past. Because you see, the past is the past. It's like what used to happen, whereas history is just what somebody wrote down on a subject. Which, if nothing else, explains why history repeats itself. Because writers plagiarize. This has been a very strange week, though. While Americans have been bantering over their basic rights and liberties, the Chinese have been bashing in the heads of bald-headed Buddhist monks in Tibet, which is quite a contrast, I think, because you don't really hear much about individual rights in China. Not for long, anyway. I sometimes think maybe it's a cultural thing with them. The subject just doesn't come up that often. You know, you're born, you're short, you have straight black hair. Why rock the boat? I mean, it's not easy to be an individual in a crowd of a billion people. You think about that, a billion people, that means that even if you're a one in a million kind of guy, there's still a thousand exactly like you. I don't know, but democracy, it seems like these days, is on the rise everywhere in the world, including China. And the reason for that is because we have something on the side of freedom here in America that's more powerful than any totalitarian army, more powerful than any dictator. Greed. It's the American dream. I mean, look at it this way. No matter how much Gorbachev consolidates his power in the Politburo, he's never going to have his own baseball franchise. And that's got to sting just a little bit somewhere along the line. Because what does it avail the man to rule the world if he doesn't have cable in his building? This is a great place, America. It's the land of opportunity, where you can get 13 albums for $1.99. And if you have any ambition, you can change your address and get 13 more. It's a place where everyone has the right to vote, provided, that is, they're willing to risk jury duty. It's the American dream, but it's an elusive dream, that dream, and I guess I could express it best with a little story. A story about rock and roll, about a man who became a king in a democracy. He was a poor kid who was raised in Tupelo, Mississippi in the early 1950s. He didn't have much. No rich parents, no formal education. All he had was a rockin' guitar, a sneer on his lip, a wiggle in his hip, and that certain something called talent. Now, unfortunately, he was black, so he never made a nickel. But a year later, Elvis Presley came along. He made almost $1 billion. So I guess being in the right place at the right time is the American dream. Not that it's a perfect place. We have racism here still to this day. They found a whole county last year in Georgia full of racists, Forsyth County. I remember the headlines. White trash bigots found in Georgia. It was a slow news day. But still, I think that headline just sums up to me racism compounded with racism, because I don't think it's fair to blame all white trash for the actions of those few. It's not gonna get us anywhere. Just because a man has a few rusty appliances in his front yard and drinks cheap liquor out of a jelly jar and sleeps with his sister, it doesn't necessarily mean he's a bigot. I know I speak for a lot of white trash when I say we resent being lumped in with the redneck peckerwoods. We're all Americans here, some of us. And there's a poem on a plaque in the base of the Statue of Liberty by Emma Lazarus. I don't know what it says or anything, but in part it goes, send me your poor, your tired, your hungry, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. Send me the wretched refuse of your teeming shores. Well, I think it's time to stop all this name-calling and live together as Americans. There's a lot of versions of the American dream. Martin Luther King had one of them, that one day in those red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners would sit down together at the table of brotherhood. It was an American dream that inspired the world. I have a dream, too. In my dream, I go to a job interview, but I'm not wearing any pants. Okay, he couldn't base a national policy on it. So I guess what I'm trying to say is that all men are not created equal. Some have greater dreams, and I guess that's the purpose of individual rights. So thank you very much.
That's good stuff.
Well, it's fun.
That's real good stuff. I remember you were here.
First time I was on television.
Is that right?
Yeah.
On the show?
Yeah, I was just thinking about it, too, because you were so nice to me. You gave me a joke.
You're kidding.
After the show. No? I think it was a routine about, well, it was about when I was a kid, I'd get broke and I'd have to pull out my brother's teeth and sell them to the tooth fairy.
Right.
To get money. And you gave me a cap or two, which was, I think it was something like, I pretty well stripped his mouth by the age of 7. Oh, he had a couple molars left, sure, but you know, to drag there to get out. And it, I just didn't think anybody else had ever experienced that as a kid.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
So it was... But I used it for a couple of years. It was a lot of fun. And finally, I sold it to Alan Thicke.
Well, I thank you for that. We'll take a break. We'll be right back. Okay, my next guest is... Alexandra Paul has been with us before. She's a very lovely young actress who's in a movie called The Passage, not The Message, before Fred corrects me. It'll be released at Christmas. Is that the holiday, Fred? Christmas. Would you welcome Alexandra Paul? Did you hear what I called you? I called you Alexander.
I know a lot of people do that.
Alexandra Paul. I'm sorry.
Paul, it's okay.
Do you like Alexander or Alex? Do they call you Alex?
Yeah, people call me Alex a lot, but I always call myself Alexandra.
Yeah.
My mom never liked shortening, so she always called us Alexandra.
Alexandra, yeah. I saw that. Now, you told me last time you weren't going to get married.
Yep,
and now you're
true.
Married.
No, I'm not married.
Well, no, what is this?
This is a wedding band. It is a...
Well, congratulations.
No. It's from my movie, The Passage, which is coming out. I did play somebody who was married, and so since I had such a great time doing it, and I guess it's sentimental. I liked being married in the movie.
Yeah.
I had kids in the movie. I liked having kids in the movie. But
well, what is this? Are you just carrying this fantasy a little further, you mean? Are you pretending that you're married?
Well, okay. It also keeps people away.
Ah, you mean when you go out, if you're not wearing that guy's hit on you?
No.
Well, sure.
Sometimes.
Does this kind of dissuade them from doing
that? I think so. I think, yeah. Because when I do wear it, people notice and they say, oh, you're married.
Yeah. You know? And that's that.
So, but I actually like wearing it, too. It is kind of, it's...
Yeah. That's all right.
I don't know. So, but...
Are you close to getting married? I don't wear one.
But you are married.
Yes.
See?
But it was taking the ring on and off so many times and putting it on. How about children? You want to have children someday?
No.
Well, you don't. That's unusual.
Yeah. I would like to adopt maybe, but not have my own. Although I get kind of nervous because a lot of people, you're right, do. And so I wonder if maybe...
Yeah, that's almost un-American. I remember years ago we had a lady on the show who wrote a book called The Baby Trap. And I can't remember her last name. I think it was Peck or something. And she came out and says, I don't think a lot of women should have children because, you know, they're selfish to have children if they can't take care of them. And the audience almost got up in arms.
Really?
And booed her, thinking that it was, you know, a woman is unnatural if she didn't want her own children. You figure you'd like to adopt because there are a lot of children who don't have homes.
Yeah, that's right. I guess I feel... that, yeah, it can be selfish to have... Everyone seems to want to have kids because it's their own kid.
Yeah.
And so I feel that it's somehow the same if it's a child, it's a person. It might not be from your genes and things.
That's refreshing to hear. There's nothing wrong with that. There are a lot of kids that need families. How about now if you got married, would your husband say, hey, I want to have, you know, it's that macho image.
Wait, I'm not getting married.
Hey, you
married.
Came from my loins.
But I'm not getting married.
Somewhere so. Around there. What?
I'm not getting married.
You're not ever going to get married?
No.
Well, never say never. Why do you say never?
Well,
what's your greatest, what's your greatest fear about getting
changing
married?
Changing my mind.
What do you mean? After you get married? How old are you?
24.
Well, 24 is very young. But you just don't ever envision getting married?
Nope.
Yeah,
but my mother says that at 29 I'm going to change my mind. So I've written in my journal, you're not going to get married, and underlined it. So when I'm 29, I'll look back and I'll know that when I was 24 and wise.
Yeah.
That
would you keep company with somebody if you're not married?
Yes. Somehow marriage...
I'm sorry.
Are you married?
Don't drag my family into this, please.
No, this is refreshing, I think, is it?
No, the thing about marriage is that if you really love somebody, it doesn't seem to me that you would have to have that insurance policy of being married, that the real commitment would be to stay with someone without being married. That would be a greater commitment than staying with someone because you're married. I don't think I'm convincing anybody here.
No, if I could have swung that, I'd have done that. But nobody seems to want to do that. People start out that way, I think. You're saying, as long as we're happy and we're together, a piece of paper, what?
Did you say that in the beginning, that you didn't need it, the formality and things like that?
Yeah, you can have as much of a commitment to another person without having a legal piece of paper. It does pose some problems. It was nice having you here again.
Thank you.
Next time you're back, I hope we have a little longer time to talk. And I wasn't trying to push you into marriage, you know that.
I know that.
Okay. Whitney, you start the season on October next Saturday?
Next Saturday, yep.
Yeah.
Steve Martin and Sting will be our host.
Great. It's nice having you here again.
Great to be here.
Thanks for coming back. And Patrick? Good luck on the movie.
Thank you.
Come back and see us soon.
I will.
I'm humbled by that applause.